That worked. Hi, Internet.
Hello.
We're live.
We did.
Yeah. We did. Welcome back. I'm Raytog. This is my goofy, well, less goofy than my usual games. This is my first attempt at running a Call of Cthulhu game, a modern horror thing, and we're going to see how this goes. Oh, cool. New followers. That's fun. Oh, that actually is rather average for our misadventures here. So, get us started off here. You might notice that the cast is rotating in this game. It's going to be rotating. We have so many slots for so many games, and we have a large number of players, some of which who have been waiting a long, long time to play in these games with us. So, before we actually get started, since we're coming back to this, I'm going to ask each of you who the hell you are and who you are playing, starting with Wallace, because this is your first time.
Yeah, so I'm Wallace. I'm playing Logan. He's kind of like a street smart guy. Kind of been on his own for a while, so he's had to learn by doing. Kind of makes his way through life the best he can. So ended up doing the wrong thing to the wrong person and has ran for help, which is not something he's usually used to doing, but this is out of his wheelhouse, so he needs a little help.
Since you spoke up, Mizui, that means you're next.
I am Miss Mizui. I am an old face on the TOG Twitch streams, but a new face here is Blair. Blair is a 40-year-old woman who used to work in antiquity collection for a museum. She was both the curator and registrar for the Witty, and she's had a couple of run-ins with like weird things happening on like excursions, and she's had like a couple of friends come by with things and like kind of go silent afterwards, and she had a run-in that got really personal, and that's when DMOS found her, and she has started working here since.
And that brings us to my friend Scarlett. You are last, but definitely not least.
I'm Scarlett. You've probably seen me on this channel before, if not in other games. I am playing Katie Dunleavy. She is a former news reporter and cryptid researcher. And through that, she has found herself here at DMOS.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Yes, she has.
Yay.
That's not ominous at all.
Mm-hmm. So, if I do recall correctly, a lot of you have elected to respond to the investigation that was titled The Focus Group. Described as a phone app is going through its pre-alpha testing phase. Something's not right. Operatives will be sent to investigate. Each of you would have gotten a confirmation email and given a time and a place to meet up for a debrief. The place is kind of wibbly-wobbly considering the nature of the DMOS building. It sort of exists in all cities at the same time, but not really, and only if you're looking for it. But for those that know about it, getting there isn't a problem, and getting to the debriefing room also, not a problem.
Oh my.
Yep. Safe at home base, and we already have an oh my. It means I'm doing my job right.
So which one's the crackpot with all the yarn?
I'm going to say that we are literally going to cut to the scene of a debriefing room where that line was literally spoken. The three of you are in the room by yourself.
Well, not me. yarn has never been my forte. This looks interesting, though. What are we looking at here?
Looking up there, you do see what looks like a a map that probably came from, like, an elementary school of the United States. And it has strings and tons of pieces of papers stapled to the wall via tacks, actual staples. One of them is stuck up there with a pencil for... There's so many that it is hard to really get, like, a good sense of all of it. Like, one of them is clearly, like, around the West Virginia line. It is clearly talking about Mothman. There's something around the Texas thing talking about Goatman's Bridge. It seems to be kind of a all-encompassing map of the continental United States.
So are you saying that this is kind of all of the current leads on stuff that's happening and not necessarily a specific board? Mm-hmm. Kind of like, oh, hey, this thing popped up. Maybe we should look at it. Okay, cool.
Not really a message board, but it seems like this is a very much a shared workspace. And people aren't, at least whilst in the confines of the building, really big on, like, keeping secrets. It's just preternatural weird shit is just kind of everywhere.
Well, at least we'll never be, you know, dead. Always have work.
I don't think those two things are mutually exclusive.
Katie just kind of stands there and blinks, looking at him like,
I like being busy. Any idea what we're supposed to be doing here? All I got was this, like, vague email to show up here.
That sounds par for the course for around here.
Great.
Blair will look around and, like, anybody else coming, maybe, to direct?
There's about 30 more seconds of awkwardness as everyone's just sitting there. The fuck now? Very, very corporate. Very, we were supposed to be here on time. We were here on time. Now what?
Is there any, like, folders or anything on the, like, I see a couple folders in the pictures.
There's just a couple folders just lying around, yeah.
Just gonna start looking through them.
Cool. You start reading a very brief dissertation of following a couple of weird kids who were apparently investigating the Goatman Bridge in Texas.
Interesting. I know absolutely nothing about this.
Made a YouTube video about it and never seen again.
My favorite kind of horror movie.
Right about. Go ahead.
If we're working together, I suppose I'm Blair. It's nice to meet you both.
Logan.
Hey.
I'm sorry, Katie?
Yeah, Katie Dunleavy.
So nice to meet you both.
Nice to meet you.
Right about then, the door you came through opens. And kind of a skinny guy comes in. He is on the tallish side. He's kind of got the whole, like, tall skin, the scarecrow kind of build, glasses, black hair. It's kind of slicked back. Wearing, it's not really business attire, but he has at least, like, a suit coat on over what is ostensibly, like, a t-shirt and jeans. Glances around quickly. Like, oh, you're already here. That'll make this easier. Papers under his arm and moves over to the desk next to you guys. Good to meet you. I'm Dr. Alan King. And I have your assignment, if you're ready for it.
Absolutely.
Well, first off, thanks for volunteering. Throws down paper folder, manila folder, opens it up, kind of spreads it out in front of him. It's not really like a lectern where an actual person in charge would stand behind and give a thing. It's just kind of this big, like, square chunks of tables that were thrown together. So it's all just kind of half-assed and sort of put together in the moment. So thanks for volunteering. We're going to be sending you guys to San Diego here. Following up on our social media team, we have discovered a company called Deep Dive Games. They're based out in San Diego, and they seem to be developing a phone game. They refer to it as T-Com, but the full name of it is apparently The Cage of Morpheus, so that set off a few alarm bells for us. And they appear to have been calling out for pre-alpha testers for this little phone game. As best as I can tell, it's supposed to be something like akin to like that Pokemon Go type thing. Like the geocaching.
Interesting.
Mm-hmm. Besides the names, the other thing that kind of set our alarm bells off is this T-Com seems to have been partnered up with a psychologist and researcher. A guy named Dr. Hans Kleck. C-L-E-K. And I do not have the information why this flagged us and this app further up the DMOS chain of command, and that is why we are sending you to investigate. As for how to get in, congratulations. He passes a few little business cards over. We've managed to get you in as posing as testers for this pre-alpha game, which really isn't actually posing, because I suppose you will actually be testing this phone game. It's not really lying. But that will be your cover to get in and get a little bit of a better look of what's going on in there.
You looking for anything specific or just general weirdness?
We don't have specifics. Right now we're lighting up as general weirdness, and we would like to get the specifics. That's you.
Gotcha.
Understood. What was it about the name Morpheus? I'm not familiar. Was that something that triggered the team? For what reason?
Just something doesn't sit right about it. I mean, I get what they're kind of going for with this, but if things start dipping a little too close to mythology and obviously don't have a mythological basis of a video game, that strikes me particularly as odd. And between you and me, and he had a bottle of water and he actually sits it down as if he's about to go on a short rant, I'm not a big fan of this Deep Dive Games. They're kind of... they're a game developer. They're kind of coming up in the world. I know what their parent company is, and I decidedly do not enjoy them. And there's just something about this that's making me suspicious. I don't actually have any hard intel on it, but it's suspicious enough for me to think warrant sending a team. And when they're putting out for pre-alpha testers, it seems like the best way to get a team in there.
Sure. Okay.
Sounds good.
Do you know if they are providing clones to pre-alpha testers, or if we're bringing our own, in which case I don't know that you want this app on our lines that we use for work.
The company phone? Well, I don't know that. My suspicion is, again, fuck these deep dive guys. I'll bet you they won't provide a phone. Just because I don't think they're polite. But I don't know. Maybe they can prove me wrong.
So is it acceptable to use our company phones? Do we need to buy phones on our way?
You do not need to buy phones on your way. And let's just say if you're using your company phones for this, which is honestly a pretty good idea, let's just say they will be thoroughly sanitized afterwards.
Wonderful. And if you had some pictures that you didn't want to lose, never mind.
You might want to consider transferring them.
That's why I haven't offered my personal phone yet.
Any other questions?
Where do we go? With San Diego, just...
He kind of like taps on one of the little business cards that were passed over to you, and it has the information. It has a San Diego address on it.
Wonderful.
Going into this, should we be going in traveling as a group, or should we be going in as if we do not know each other? What is?
I believe that is entirely up to you. I don't think it would really matter either way. But I am not about to tell my team how they should be conducting themselves in the field.
I just didn't know if the office had an official stance on that, so...
Not really.
Probably draw less attention if we don't go in as a group. Become friends when we're there, that's a little less conspicuous.
Sure. Are they already started? Can we just show up and is there a time we're supposed to be there? And she'll examine her card again. Is this information there?
The information is there, but when you ask the question, he goes, I'm pretty sure you'll arrive in time. And he has that real straight face.
Great. That's lovely. I'm more than appreciative of that.
He kind of nods, slides his glasses up his nose a little further, and goes, well, best of luck. And he kind of taps desk and gangly, awkwardly, like, speed walks out like he's got 12 places to be, leaving you both briefly in this room together.
I'm super confident about this plan. Who else is super confident about this plan?
I've gone into worse situations. With less information, so I mean,
yeah, true. We at least know what we're doing.
Yeah, the company's backing us, so you know they'll at least know to come looking for us if we go missing, right? Yeah.
I guess we head out. Or do we have any special equipment we can pick up at our office?
Well, I need to grab my bag before we leave. It's just whenever I, it's an old habit, but whenever I go out, I like to take it with me. I don't know if there's anything else you guys would like to prepare. I have snacks.
Always important.
I don't think... No. I think I'm good.
I carry light all the time, so I already have my stuff.
I just have to stop by reception.
Sounds good.
Okay. Generally, this would just be a pretty quick snap scene change to, and you arrive.
That's fine.
But what were you looking to do at reception?
She's her phone and her religious symbols and things are in her bag, so she just leaves it at the...
Everybody will pass by reception to pick up their shit on the way out the door. Because if you missed it in the first episode, religious symbols, number two pencils... Anything smart stays at the front door. technology doesn't apparently fly very well here, or perhaps it flies too well and might cause problems. But in DMOS fashion, each and every one of you walked into this building today from a different place. You're all from different parts of the country. When you walk out, you're in a parking lot and it definitely smells like the sea.
Still never get over that.
It's weird every time.
Mm-hmm.
Well, at least we don't have to pay for gas.
And I'm sure.
No long flights.
One of you, whoever has been designated the driver, doesn't matter who, is given a pair of keys when you walk out the front door. And when you go out the front door, you go to hit the button to see which is your car that you will be taking out. And oh boy, it's like a 2001 gold Ford Taurus.
Boop. I guess we'll have to park down the block and walk.
Probably smart, yeah. Shady company, all kinds of money, can't get us a really nice car.
No. At least it's not a minivan this time.
It probably runs effectively, I mean.
I never thought I'd see one worse than my car.
I don't even want to know where they pulled this from. That's just dope.
Let's make this fun. Who, first off, is Logan driving?
No.
Okay,
my
cool.
Driving is terrible.
Cool. Give me, we're gonna do our first roll of the night. I'm gonna have you, Logan, get on your character sheet and click on it will be spot hidden.
Oh no.
Because you're like, I wonder where this came from. Looks around. So that's really good. So we're going to do a couple of things here for rules. So everybody knows. Logan has just rolled a successful check. You see that little like dot that looks like you could click on it and put a little dot in there? Click on it so that you remember that you have rolled a success on this particular skill. Because after the game, we will do some rolls to see if that skill improves. You improve skills in this game by using them. And so click that just so you remember which ones you did so we can do that later.
Gotcha.
Now to the fact that you actually succeeded. You check in the back seat. Looks fine. You check in the floor of the back seat. There are tiny little flecks of red, and the carpet is cut in a perfectly straight line with a little jagged portion there.
Should have guessed.
You rolled a 14. That's pretty low, which is good in this game. That door and those windows are new.
I don't want to sit in the back seat. Shotgun.
I'll drive.
Oh, all right. That's fine. I'm not a great driver anyway.
The tradition continues. Oh, vampire game joke.
Your seat forward. Need some leg room.
Well, don't worry. Fine. She takes about 5 minutes. You're like, what? How long does it take you to adjust a seat? Steering wheel, whole thing.
And I don't have it on here anymore, and Matt will thank me for it, but when you do turn on the car, immediately polka.
Polka will never die.
And it lasts as long as it takes our driver to punch the volume button. But
maybe she's into it. We don't know.
You don't know? I don't know.
You see just a small eyebrow twitch, and it's just boop. The slow, deliberate reach for the radio.
And I have killed everyone in the chat. The traditions will continue. So you guys head out. There is an actual old, like, not on a phone, a old GPS in this car. That is just a GPS and nothing else. It's like a TomTom or something. And
God.
I think I saw one of Wallace's brain vessels burst. it isn't really hard to get there. When you've exited, no matter when you entered the building, it's getting kind of close to night. And the place that you are driving up to actually turns out to be in a pretty nice part of town. It's a little on the isolated side. And it seems that this test, for whatever reason, is being conducted at a sleep clinic. You pull up, and that's the exterior of the place.
Because that's not shady at all.
Yeah, it's really weird.
Once I see the building, I'm gonna go just around the block and park.
Okay.
Somewhere, you know, a little bit farther away from the building.
Fair. Don't want the old Ford Taurus to get noticed with its plumes of smoke.
Get pulled over. California, you know? Got rules about this.
So it's a little bit of a drive. Is anybody, while they're on their way here, doing anything? You have a little bit of information, and I remind you, this is modern day, so y'all have cell phones. This, in fact, is a game about cell phones.
Right. Blair will look up the game and just kind of see what, if there's anything being said online about it, what's going on, as far as what their advertising is to try and attract these testers.
Doing the same thing.
So you're all right, so let's do it this way. This is going to be a different role. In other games this might be like a technology sort of thing, but in essence with a modern day game, because I'm trying to retrofit Call of Cthulhu to a modern thing, this would be a library use role, because you were looking up information. You're just doing it electronically. It'd be, how is your Google foo?
And then I just clicked on the library use button, mm-hmm. and it rolls it.
There you go.
Me do the same thing too.
If you are rolling as well, go for it. Nope. So when Logan's looking the stuff up, you can't really find a lot at all. And you kind of get the impression that, oh right, this game actually isn't released yet. So it makes sense that you're probably not able to find a whole lot. So, Blair, you got a success there. Give me a little more specifics on what you're looking for, and let's see what you find.
So, she's actually looking for people who have tried to get into the alpha and been successful, or the pre-alpha and been successful or been denied. People who claim to be part of it and what their experiences are. If they have a... you said it's kind of like Pokemon Go, right? So, If they have some sort of channel or meetup for those people and what they're discussing about their experience with the game so far. So, really just the user side information of their experience.
So, you succeeded, but I'm very sorry to tell you that your success basically leads you to Reddit. and you do find... It's like on one of the weird subreddits that is talking about like new games in development and stuff like that. You find something that is tagged TCOM, which is the abbreviated version of what you're looking for. You find a user whose apparent username is Big Dave with a string of numbers after it that. Talks a little bit about the game, and it isn't really terribly informative, but it seems like he was invited to the original round of pre-alpha and said that it was like another geocaching game that used your phone's camera, similar to Pokemon Go and things like that, but
augmented reality, or just uses the camera?
A little bit of both. It was like a clue-finding game, but he said that there were a few good things about it and a few bad things about it. It was interesting because it looked like the game logic was kind of like, it had like what is referred to as fuzzy logic. so it could like give you a clue of the thing, like it would tell you a riddle, and then you could like point your phone camera at something that the riddle is referring to, and it would recognize whether or not that would be correct. And that technology was actually pretty cool. But the next full paragraph is just talking about how expletive field annoying the music was. Like, it was absolutely terrible to the point of, like, couldn't keep listening to it for more than 10 minutes, had to stop. It was the worst ever.
Any side effects from listening for those 10 minutes, or... did he report, oh man, it gave me a killer headache every time I tried to play?
He reported massive annoyance.
Okay.
As you would expect a Reddit user to do.
Like infuriating? Would you say it was mildly infuriating?
He seems like he's very upset in this write-up. Like, this game has, like, some hope, but... oh my god, if they don't change this music, this is the biggest piece of dog shit I have ever played in my life. This ruins the whole experience. They have gold in their hands, but they're fucking useless. Reddit string goes on.
Sure. Okay.
What happens if you search for the psychiatrist that they were consulting with?
I'm going to let you have another library use on that.
I'm going to fail epically. You can might. I give the idea to Blair?
So there's a couple... You can make an open success, but there's also a couple of things we could do with it. First off, I'm just going to say, go make your roll first. Then we'll see how this goes. So that is a significant failure.
Yes.
There's a couple of ways we can do failures in this game, if you want. And this is, again, the first few games with the first groups, I'm going to be laying out the rules. If you fail a roll and you're like, fuck, I really need to pass this roll, you could tell me, I want to push it. And then give me a reason what you're going to do that could possibly turn that role from a failure to a success. I do this or that. So you can basically just roll again. If you fail when you're pushing it, this book here says that I get to make up what the consequences are, because there has to be a consequence.
Right.
Or, if you want to use your luck, you are able to reduce your luck score to make... that pass, but in this roll's case, that is a real big gulf.
Mm-hmm.
So you're either going to need to try and push it if you want, or hey, somebody else try this.
So I suck at Google. I'm just not good with the phones. Did you find anything about like the psychiatrist? Like, I know you found the game, but like, I can't find anything.
But you know, I can look. What were you thinking? Like, just what his background is, or...
My guess would be why. I mean, if this is just a regular, like, Pokemon Go type game, why do you need a psychiatric person consulting? That's weird.
You know, that is weird. Okay.
Like, what is his field of study, maybe? That might tell us what he was consulting on.
Sure, and maybe he's published some papers that'll give us some, like, background on what he's worked on in the past. Yeah, I can look into him. Did you remember his name? And she'll...
It's Hans Click.
Yeah, Hans Click.
Thank you. Perfect.
The German guy. Always the German guys.
So I'll just roll that again now?
Yep. Hard success. So that's pretty good. Bing. You do find it. There's something going on with your phone there, Logan. The Google does not respond. I don't know if it is because of the things, the pictures that shouldn't be on the company phone, or if they picked anything up, but your internet search isn't working the way it's supposed to.
Have you tried turning safe search off?
Clear your cookies. Clear your cookies. So, Blair, you do find stuff. A quick internet search on Dr. Click. Gives you a professional biography. He's a consulting psychologist who lists clients including several game developers, product developers, and just several unnamed sports stars and celebrities. This guy seems to be billing himself out as some kind of like life coach or a performance optimizer with research interests including like deficit disorders, improving sleep, improving attention spans. With a hard success, you get a bunch of stuff. His credentials that you find appear to be legitimate. Like, they pass a cursory search of this guy is just some bullshit or... So it seems like he does have a doctorate in these things. They include an undergraduate degree in psychology from the Netherlands, which, with a hard success, you find out he got that in 1979. A PhD in psychology from UCLA in 86. You get a picture of him too. He's like a thin, bald guy.
So kind of show that to everybody.
Nice face. He's also listed as a CEO of a company that runs the adjoining sleep clinic that you are going up to. Kleck Sleep Improvement LLC, which caters to people with sleep apnea and other sleep disorders. And with a hard success, you also find that no hint of any criminal activity or occult shenanigans on the part of Dr. Kleck can be found in a quick internet search.
Forgive me, you said sleep clinic is called what? Or did you give me a name there?
Kleck Sleep Improvement LLC.
And then it's specifically for sleep apnea and...
Helps people with sleep apnea and other sleep disorders.
Okay. Wonderful. So she will give out most of this information. Obviously, she's got a lot, so not all that's relevant. She'd be like, oh yeah, he's a doctor, seems to be trying to cater himself to, like, celebrities and big names here. He does work with deficit disorders, especially like ADHD and or sleep disorders, and this is actually probably one of his clinics, certainly one that his company owns. His name's on it online, so I assume that's him. He seems legit as far as everything goes. Nothing really stands out. She'll show the picture she found too.
What about this parent company that what's his face mentioned?
Since you have stopped driving the car, I'm going to say you've gotten to your parking spot. If you want to do the library use and look that up.
Yep.
You certainly can. And again, if you succeed on a check, be sure to click the little dot next to it to remind yourself that you succeeded. When we get to the end. Another hard success. Fantastic. Tell Seamus not to crawl out of his skin. The company that is doing this is called it's Deep Dive Games, and they're owned by the Pentex Corporation.
Ooh.
Which has wide world-spanning things, like a bunch of different things in the medical division, in electronics and entertainment. It's a bunch that has stuff all over the world in a million different things. And the Deep Dive Games appears to be a nudge into the electronic entertainment division.
Sorry, I missed half of that because he was just banging on the goddamn wall.
Oops.
So, for reference, Pentex is, what's his name's company, right? That we murdered in Chicago?
Nope.
No? Different?
Different.
Oh. What was his company? Doesn't matter.
Doesn't matter. You don't know.
When the company was in Chicago earlier this year, I remember there was like a big tech company that we talked about. There's a whole IRS thing. It's okay, you know.
I try to not regard chat a whole lot, but shut up, Beans.
Oh, Beans.
With my hard success, can I find any current or past controversies?
For Pentex Corporation? Think of the equivalent if... controversies, definitely. There's questions about like how environmentally sound they are. There's, think if you had
BlackRock,
Amazon, and like Elon Musk all mushed together, and all of the weird shit that might have come from them. There is like one of the biggest companies around that doesn't really get mentioned that much because it is a parent company of a million more well-known companies.
So we can assume environmental and human rights?
Human rights for sure. Yep. Shit like definitely like overcharging people in pharmaceuticals. Shit like that. As a reporter, Pentex is like, oh, okay. The corporation. Like, if you had to like put a finger on a nose of what is an evil corporation, these guys.
All right. I probably researched them for news stories in the past about this shit.
A couple of things that might have had been like adjacent to some of the spooky cryptid shit that you were looking up, but nothing that you could ever actually find any substantiated ties to.
No, I meant her like legitimate stuff when she actually did work for the news.
I'm implying both.
Oh, okay, cool. She's like, well, their parent company is Pentex, so that's fun.
I have no idea who that is.
Yes, you do. They run everything. They own everything.
Oh. Okay. I mean, I live on the road, so I mean, like, I say Walmart, I know Walmart.
They own that.
Ah. Gotcha. And now they're making Pokemon Go with psychiatrists.
Right. Actually, sorry. Does Katie relay all that information to us?
She says basically what I actually said.
Okay.
Really shitty company that owns everything.
The other interesting thing I found is that from the user's perspective, I found just one dude on the internet who was really mad. I think it's interesting that what he complained about was like the music was really, he said, like annoying. He seemed really mad about it. He went on and on. He said he couldn't listen to it for more than like 10 minutes at a time. It was really just, you know, a problem, ruined the whole game. And, you know, music is really important in video games. I don't know if you guys play a lot of video games, but it tends to be one of the things that they really focus on as part of the game experience. And we're talking about a psychiatrist and a sleep clinic sponsoring or funding, perhaps, this game. And I wonder if there is some sort of parallel here, since we're looking into things that might be weird about this creepy, weird, bad music and the effect on the mind that they're looking at.
I mean, that's definitely a thing. Certain sounds can mess with you psychologically all the time. I can tell you the easiest way to steal somebody is have a certain sound to distract them.
Sure, right.
So my guess is they're probably throwing something in this game to try to see what happens if they change different sounds, different lights. I have out of game. I have a lot in psychology. Could I try to like roll so I can explain this in a way that I can't physically, because I don't know a lot of it. Okay.
Absolutely. Roll of psychology. Also, in this game, so that's a hard success. Fantastic.
Nice.
So, also, note in this game that if you are trying to tell if a person is lying to you, psychology is the role. So, once again, Wallace, be sure to click the little dot that you rolled that score, and you did well. There are a lot of things that sounds and game design have in common. If you are asking me to explain stuff as Logan would and that you cannot, is that what I'm understanding correctly?
Well, just more of like, I'm trying to convey that he has the knowledge that.
Got it.
More than likely, what this is a subliminal advertisement. It's subliminal messing with your brain, especially if he's complaining about the music. I bet any money it's a mixture of music and lights and sounds and everything messing with your brain and trying to change your brain chemistry to get you to do what they want. And I believe that's what they're doing with this app. We got to figure out a way to test that. Kind of wish I had some earplugs right now.
But you know what? This is the exact sort of thing that I think that we can hand wave. So you just have those.
Cool. You've told us those things.
There we go.
I feel like yep. I feel confident in your assessment of psychology at this
point. Yep.
Perfect. That's what I was trying to get to.
Excellent.
So I guess we go up individually, sign up, and get whatever we need to be rolling with this, and then we'll...
Do we want to... yes, absolutely, I think so. Do we want to create our own control of somebody who does not listen to the music? Or the sounds of the game?
Let me do that, so that way I could try to talk to you guys afterwards, because I can kind of gauge when somebody's acting off.
Sure, absolutely. If you've got experience in there, I don't.
Yeah, I'd rather not expose myself to an anger music if I can help it. So I already have the earplugs. I'll just put the earplugs in and hide them, and cool. Then I can check you guys and make sure, you know, if it's starting to look bad, I can give you earplugs or something like that.
Sure, absolutely. Okay.
Considering this psychologist specializes in sleep, I mean, it's well known that sleep deprivation is the easiest way to manipulate people.
True.
So I think
anything about long-term sleep effects online, but
I think we have a good
anything long-term exists yet.
I think we have a good plan going in right now. It's just we'll try to once we get in there, we'll link up. You know, hi, you know, act like we never met. And then you just try to keep an eye out for each other and try not to get separated as much as we can.
Sure, absolutely.
Okay. We should definitely go in staggered. Someone goes in, someone else waits 4 minutes. Someone else goes in, someone else then waits 11 minutes and goes in.
Sure, a random staggered entrance.
Sounds good to me. I'll head up.
Okay. One of you leaves the party and they die.
you step out of the car, the emissions immediately, the car backfires, you die.
I could go to the vampire and just make fun of mad car lava. Bombs. I don't know.
Floor is lava.
Floor is lava. So, Logan goes in first. What you find inside, in which the others will find eventually, is the waiting room in the front hall. I mean, it's pretty nice. It's pretty nice in there.
Is there a reception or anything? Or
there is like sort of kind of a reception in that little bulletin board that you see when you walk in has like a little arrow on it shaped like a hand that somebody drew in dry erase, and it said TCOM test.
I'll head in that direction.
And it points at essentially you travel around the inside a little bit till you get to this room where there's a couple of chairs. There's a couple people all there already, specifically two. One is I want to say probably like 18, 19 female. You get a vibe immediately that she is completely aloof, not really paying attention. She is on her phone, she's doing selfies, got like one like green streak in her hair, and the rest of the world does not exist at all. Doesn't know that you're there. The other is I want to say late 20s, early 30s guy, skinny dude. Kind of mop of like curly hair, staring down at his phone. Clothes are a little too baggy for him. Looks up when you come in, kind of gives you one of these, and then goes back to his phone. And that's anybody, it.
Anybody know what's going on with this testing thing? Like,
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we're good. They said wait a couple more minutes.
Cool. All right. I'll sit down where I'm kind of an equal distance between the two of them.
To save time. Nothing supernatural or interesting happens in the time where Logan is there by himself. It is a boring waiting room. There's a little bit of vibe of this place, though. It's a sleep clinic is a weird thing to be in. It's a place that handles human beings when they are unconscious. And there's a lot of stuff going on with the architecture that makes people feel like comfortable. But you, being you, Logan, know that is absolutely a manufactured thing, and you would not trust that instinctually. But it is definitely set up. You can tell when you come in, it's designed to, like, disarm and put people at ease. But that's just doctor's offices, too.
Yep.
Both Blair and Katie eventually come in at their allocated predestined times, and it's all coordinated exactly how you want it to. Plan doesn't have any possibilities of going wrong with that, so there's no need for dice rolls or any nonsense like that. You're all eventually in, the same kind of brief greetings. And then, eventually, a guy enters the room. He's kind of like preppy looking, got like a sweater vest going on. He's younger. You figure that he's like 25 max. Hi, everybody. I'm Sam Weldon. I'm the game developer for TCOM, and I'm glad that you guys showed up today. Appreciate it. As a reminder, so we're going to get you all set up for this test. This is, of course, a paid test. Again, we really appreciate you coming in as a blind audience for an hour of your time. This marketing research group that we're working with will pay you guys $1,500 for this little focus group. And I'm going to have you guys fill out this paperwork right here. Standard non-disclosure stuff. Nothing really important going on with it, but fill that out, and as soon as you're done, come on through the door, and I'll direct you guys to where we're doing this test. And he walks out of the room.
I'm gonna kind of like, I'm assuming we've been having small talk between the three of us.
Yep.
Like, trying to get the whole, like, hey, you said you're a librarian, right? Oh, shit.
Yes. The cover is immaculate. And also, these younger people that are in there with you are not paying attention to you, basically, at all. They're teenagers. And just, yeah, they're... The female is absolutely lost in her phone. If anybody leans over and snoops, they're definitely scrolling on something that looks like TikTok, but isn't.
TikTok from Wish.
Seems like it's the other way around. Seems like the number of interactions and text scrolling is greater than one would go on TikTok. This is giving you kind of the vibe of like, is this like the next iteration? Is this what the kids are doing these days? Am I behind?
How old there... How old is Katie? Wallace is Carrie.
Logan.
I'm in my 20s. But like late 20s.
Sure. I just realized that Blair probably 26. Stands out. Yeah, so Blair really stands out here.
She kind of does.
As like, she's 42. She's the oldest person in this alpha. Or pre-alpha test. I'm sorry, I was listening to all the ages and going, oh, she's not matching here.
Yep.
Okay.
The odd lady out.
Cool.
Katie is going to very intently read the entirety of this document.
That's where I was going with one of you two, because I don't understand any of this.
You, once again, do not actually need to make a roll to read this. You, it's right in front of you. You can read it. It is...
Understanding.
Well, as because of your background as a reporter, this actually is pretty much copy and pasted the standard kind of NDA. You do specifically note that the Pentex Corporation is not mentioned at all, only Deep Dive Games. And it doesn't seem like the penalties are listed as particularly like severe or anything. Some of these NDAs are really big on like, oh, if you reveal this stuff, there can be legal consequences. This one seems much lighter, actually. This seems like significantly less serious than other paperwork you've seen of types like this.
Hmm.
It's pretty lightweight. I mean, if you blab about this sort of thing, like, yeah, it seems like they probably won't be happy, but who knows? Maybe they like the free advertisement.
No sly things in there that they've snuck in. It's all very upfront and normal.
I will let you do a, since it is in front of you, I will let you do a spot hidden. Because you would be digging through.
There it is.
See if you can spot something. Nope.
Nope.
This is my favorite thing to do. Looks fine.
It's these shit.
Looks fine.
Seems clear.
But I was gonna do like a little like adjusting of her glasses while she's looking at this, like maybe she's having trouble reading it, and then she's gonna pull out her phone and like clearly zoom in,
magnifying,
and magnify. But she's going to use this actually as a cover for just like taking pictures to make sure that they have the thing in case it's relevant.
Fancy. Are you being sneaky about this?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, sort of. She's very clearly putting on a show of magnifying the pages, but the photos would be sneaky.
Did you turn the flash off?
No.
The first time I opened the phone app, the camera, I turned the flash off. Are you kidding? How are you going to sneak pictures of a stranger if the flash goes off?
Because I'm still learning all of the skills that are in Call of Cthulhu. I'm going to say that is going to be a sleight of hand skill. You do note that nobody's really paying that much attention to you, but you're trying it anyway, so this will be an opportunity for you to maybe use a skill and maybe be able to improve it. Nope. You're very obviously taking pictures. You're like, we're doing it. And you hit the thing and it goes, really loud. Oh!
Oh! Whoops! Trying to zoom in. Click, click.
But you do get pictures of the NDA.
And you I guess I'll sign it a different name.
Completely fake name. That's perfectly fine.
Completely fake name.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Okay.
Like, same.
Yeah, absolutely.
Steve.
Yes, that's perfect. With people who have just actually met Steve today, and people who are just trying to learn their character's name. Let's remember a third set of fake names on top of all of that.
Oh, it's easy. Every fake name I'm going to have, the last name is going to be from a rock band.
Hatfield. Yeah, okay, so you started off really good. I approve of this.
Send my Jane Eyre.
Fantastic. Right. She's going to sign Sarah McEllis.
Fantastic. All right. So
look what I started.
You all sign the two other people. The younger girl finally disengages with her social media, although you notice that she's holding her phone out like this. This is clearly a person who is addicted to being on a phone. It's like holding it off to the side, like while she's signing stuff, almost like maybe she's shooting video of herself signing the stuff.
Oh God, she's an influencer.
And she does turn back to the camera and wink. The guy, much more boring about it, kind of like you guys, just signs it, gets up, and moves through. I'm going to say, Blair, you give me a psychology roll. Excellent. So, first off, put that thing there, because that's 20 is real low, and hopefully you'll be able to improve that.
Not as low as sleight of hand.
This guy seems like he's done this before, seems like he's gone through these motions before, and seems mildly irritated to be here. With an 11 out of 100, which is a good roll, you have a pretty good... You think it's a pretty good chance that this guy here might be said Big Dave.
Oh, neat. Okay.
The Redditor.
Yeah. I remember. I took notes.
Okay.
She'll kind of, peer over at his paperwork to check. See if she can read his name.
I'm not going to make you make a roll for that.
I say, if that gets really obvious, she'll be like... Dave, do you know what we're getting into here?
Dave McMillan.
Cool.
But eventually they both stand up and go. I assume everybody follows, yes?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You go up a flight of stairs. This game developer just kind of leads you on. And you get to a... decidedly more warm and kind of like homey kind of office. Definitely. This seems like somebody's office. It's nice and cool in here. Like wood, everything is wood paneled. There seem to be like sort of knickknacks kind of like everywhere. And that also seems like it would probably be like a good thing for a game like this, because if you're going to be pointing your phone at things, you have a wide selection in this room.
Do any of these knickknacks or things stick out as more than just like cheap tchotchkes?
There's a lot of cheap tchotchkes. For that,
I was also kind of just looking around.
You're too. Asking for some big stuff, so I'm going to ask you to give me a spot hidden, and we'll see how good you get. You got extreme success.
I'm going to do the same, if that's okay.
That's perfectly fine.
We're in Blair's wheelhouse. We didn't know what the video game was going to be, but here we are.
Hard success. 4 and an 11. Cool. Katie, this shit's weird. This isn't your wheelhouse.
No.
You are a person of facts and like stories and... when you do your investigations, it's usually through piles of newspapers and internet articles.
Yeah.
For
but
Logan,
she's gonna try.
No, she's looking. Everybody's kind of looking around.
Whole room.
In the room, Logan, you at least find like, so it's a large, it's kind of like an office, there's like an oval conference table. Walls are lined with bookshelves. And you can tell with a hard success of 11, which is still really good, that there's a bunch of journals on sleep and psychology and sleep studies and things like that. There's a few objects that seem like they'd probably be out of place, which you assume they're probably placed out for like the game. There's like a ceramic like beer stein that's like kind of like weird and doesn't look like it would belong there, like a little red Christmas nutcracker soldier, like a old manual typewriter that people clearly aren't like using anymore. On one of the like on the desk kind of like front and center, there seems to be this little like sock monkey toy that's just kind of like sitting there. You kind of look around and see all that. Blair. This is supremely your wheelhouse. on the shelf. Roundabout back in this picture here where you would see the ducks.
Okay.
One of the things holding up one of those stacks of books is this little box. Looks like it's wood. It's got brass, kind of like on the corners. There's a lot of little things in this room that look like, oh, these might have been here for a while. Oh, this is like a pretty, like, this is like the office of a person who has studied a lot of weird stuff and maybe a little eclectic. That box looks old. Capital O. Exactly the sort of kind of thing you might have dug for in your career up until this point.
Okay.
It with is. An E at the end.
She will examine it more closely.
It is very pointedly behind the desk, and it is not a point where you can, like, get to, like, around everybody and all the little things that are set up, but you can see from where you are that is a box. It's about smallish, about that big. Outside is brass. Not the outside. Lined in brass. Hard black, black wood. And from this distance, you can't really see, but it looks like there's the telltale little, like, squiggles of potentially, like, little writing on it.
Okay.
And while you guys are doing that, both doing your quick thing and Blair is immediately, like, locked in on this box, Sam Weldon, the game dev, begins going into his whole spiel about the Cage of Morpheus and this new game that we're developing from Deep Dive Games, and it's very it's a very, like, kind of speech you would give a boardroom. You get the idea that this guy is probably more of a salesman than he is actually a game dev. But he gives you all, like, quick instructions. There's little, like, pieces of paper that are given out with, like, the Wi-Fi password, which, ironically, is Young with a J. Is it the psychologist for the psychology thing? They gives you a quick, like, QR code link to essentially the Play Store, but it's not listed on the Play Store because this isn't, like, actually out yet sort of thing. So you can basically download the pre-alpha of this game to start messing around with it. And it's listed T-Con, little dark icon, just like a T on it.
So, is he done with, like, his whole speech now? He's getting us ready to, like, start playing, essentially?
Yep.
I walk up to him, like, so you kind of just want us to stress test this, right? Like, try to find the cracks and what's not working, what works, right?
Absolutely. Yep. We've had a couple of tests already, and we definitely want feedback on what is working. We definitely want to have feedback on what is not working. So that we can make this as a fun a game as we possibly can. And you hear him say that, and you hear him say those words, but you hear the inclination, we want to make as much money off of this game as we can.
Right. So, you know, I consider myself a gamer. A lot of people complain that the end games never really work right, and I think it's because in testing, you don't got the time for us to sit here and grind for hours. Got any, like, cheat codes get us a little bit toward the end of the game? That way we can see the ending and try to help you out with that?
No, I'm afraid that part isn't really available for the pre-alpha yet. You see how this functions is less of a... There isn't really an end game because the beginning of the game kind of doesn't stop. It's a riddle game. You'll be able to find solutions to our things with any of the things around you. Maybe it'll ask you a question. You might need to, like, drive to a location you know to get the correct answer and then get the points. And those points will unlock harder riddles. And he goes into a spiel that you know is absolutely bullshit. No psychology role needed.
Well, I'm trying to is persuade him to give me, like, admin access.
Okay. That's definitely like, going to be a role here. We're going to say that is actually because this was set in the 1940s originally, that skill is called fast talk because it's basically attempting to get a person to do something via talking as opposed to like sleight of hand. So go ahead and fire it off.
That would be like a persuade.
I mean, it could be a persuade. Do you want it to be a persuade?
I would rather do persuade than fast
roll,
talk.
Go and roll persuade. So that ain't bad. So what exactly are you trying to give him? Like, trying to get, like, admin access?
Just enough to be, like, if we're starting to see something weird in the game that I can tweak a setting or just look at the settings or even see the code side of it, maybe. Something I could see the back end of stuff.
So he kind of, like, rolls his eyes a little bit, like, okay, so what I can do, and he, like, gets around and gets on your phone a little bit, and the thing opens, and essentially you do see, like lines of code basically going on the side, so it's kind of, like, in developer mode a little bit, so you can kind of see what's going on in the code frame, but the way it works is, like, this is probably as most as you're going to get. Which is more than you had before.
Is it still on my phone? Or is
it,
like,
it is on your phone.
Screenshots.
Yep. Screenshots. Done. Easy.
So now the eggheads back at base have, you know, pictures of the code.
The eggheads are getting referred to a lot, and I'm sure they really like that. Please put those in your after action reports. I'm sure it's going to be fine.
All right, cool.
So everybody gets their machines, like their phone set up. The app is downloaded. Our wonderful game dev, Sam Weldon, is in the room. Also sitting in the room, who is just kind of like off to the side and being like kind of like not really trying to interfere or anything, smiling and looking like as she's just kind of happy to be here, is, as Blair found before, Dr. Hans Kleck. And you get a really clear idea, seeing as there's a little nameplate on his desk, that this is his office.
For the purposes of the game, as he explained, are we expected to stay within this room for this test? Is that the...
Let me get this for you. So, you already signed your papers and everything. So basically, the game is going to be tested inside this room alone. The whole thing, we're going to run through some things for about an hour in game time, not like in real life time. To get the full effect of it. So yes, it is restrained within the confines of this particular office, which I want to say is probably about double sized from what the picture is showing. Imagine if the room extended about that far back behind you is what you can see in the picture. So it's not really cramped with this many people. But yes.
And just to reiterate, she did show everybody the picture, so everybody here recognizes Hans as he sits in his
little chair. He's just standing right there. And there's even like, this is very exciting. Just watching, just kind of talking to himself. Our game dev kind of like walks over and is like standing next to the doctor. Like, you get a vibe that they're kind of buddies, or at least like colleagues.
So we can just go ahead and get started then.
I guess we should. And the lady the young girl who was there. Flicks the thing to start, and you hear a little tone start up on her phone. And if you all do the same, the test is basically going to begin here. But I would say, as we have reached the hour of 10 o'clock in my time zone, this is normally about where we have our mid-session break. So, what we're going to do is we're going to take like 10 minutes, everybody go to the bathroom, get a drink, something like that. I'm going to get some water because I've been talking a lot. And we shall return and see if the cage of Morpheus is as fun as it seems to be.
Dun, dun, dun.
I'm sure it's fine.
Don't worry, it's fine. Ribs grow back.
No, sit down. All right. See you guys in like 10 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you. Rabbit run, rabbit run, run, run. Run, rabbit run, rabbit run, run, run. Bang, 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 bang goes the farmer's gun. Run, rabbit, run, 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 run. Run, rabbit, run, run, run. Don't give the farmer his fun, fun, fun. He'll get by without his rabbit paw. So run, rabbit, run.
We are unmuted, and we're coming back. Did it work? It worked. I didn't screw it up.
Yeah, I'm familiar with the comeback.
Dun, dun, dun.
Fantastic.
So, fantastic.
So, you guys all fire up your phones. Basically, the little blilly pops up with the logo. And for the most part, there's not actually very much of a UI to this game. It is just your camera showing the room in front of you, with like a little overlay on the outside of it showing you that you're in fact in an app, and like TCOM across the top. It asks you to all do a 360 degree scan of the room, which once done, the game seems like it kind of activates. Yep. A music starts. And for the purposes of this storytelling experience, I'm not actually going to be playing the music in question. But I will tell you that it is similar to the repetitive kind of nature of like an old NES game. And if the Soulful Sounds of Mario jump to your mind first, it's like that if it was written by a cat going across a keyboard. It's not really... The rumors are true, the music is kind of dick.
You know what? Blair's got no tact. She'd be like, oh, I don't know if I'm a fan of this music to start. Does it change, or is it like this the whole time?
Sam, the developer, oh, no, it's like this the whole time. We've done some work on it. And in response, the guy standing next to you is like, it sounds the same to me from last time. And he kind of grumps a little bit as he tries to get his thing to scan the whole room. He seems upset.
Well, is it necessary, or can I turn it down?
Oh, it's definitely necessary. Trust me, it's not going to be that much of a problem. We have done some work on it from last time. There were some reports of it being a little too much, and we did some stuff to it. Specifically, Logan, I want you to give me another spot hidden. Because this is shit that has going on with you, so no. I'll give it to Blair, too, because she's actively talking to that side of the room. You know, no, I'm going to give it to both of you. Give it to everybody. Spot hiddens. Hard success. Oh, Katie.
Oh, my God. All right.
Nice.
The doctor, Dr. Kleck, when everyone's complaining about the music, he's still standing there, just still nice. Bald, happy, like 40s gentleman, has flesh colored earplugs in. Hard to notice.
I'm kind of just watching everybody and trying to gauge like any effects or anything I'm noticing as they're like playing the start of it.
Okay. So, you're kind
of... Yeah, I'll get it. Just focus.
You're kind of... So, Logan's kind
analyzing
of
them.
Focusing on the people rather than the game. Kind of going through the motions with the game just enough to keep going, but you're looking at the people. Blair is like...
I can't hear anything.
Blair is in the game. What's Katie doing?
She's gonna kind of slowly play the game. You know, give some wrong answers just to slow herself down, just to see what kind of happens.
Fantastic.
And kind of keep an eye on.
Okay. So, some things need to happen before Logan is actually going to find anything going on with people. So, beginning of the game starts. And after the full 360 degree turn, you guys, through the thing on your camera, not in real life, but kind of in AR, there's like blue footprints that lead up to the desk, right in front of where that little sock monkey is sitting.
Katie's gonna try and see if she can minimize the app. Does it like let you?
Nope, not even a little.
Okay. So
he's
gonna point at the monkey.
Okay. So, you kinda go up to the monkey. And you look at it, you can tell there's a little, like, there's like at one of those tiny delays in frame rates where you know the phone's actually doing something. Logan specifically sees code starting to run. Not in real life, but in the phone, the sock monkey, like, tilts and, like, looks up at you. And a little voice starts coming out of your phone. It's like, "Welcome to the Cage of Morpheus. I have a hidden special gem, but you will have to be wise and crafty to figure out where it hides, because it sits among others that sleep in the month of August this year, found within 42 dead leaves." There's a whole thing going on with that.
Okay.
And if none of that makes sense at all, we can simply go with rolls. And the little monkey's like waving his little hands around a little bit, animated. And you do one of those, like, and like move your phone off to the side, like, no, it didn't really move. You put your phone up and it's moving again.
Okay. I mean, things that go to sleep in the month of August among dead leaves are cicadas. Are we riddle solving, or are we looking at something at the picture?
You are riddle solving.
Okay.
How deafened am I by my earplugs? Can I at least hear that, or?
Let's say because you're smart enough to have the code running, and also because you have the options, you are afforded subtitles. So you Perfect. Can be exactly as deaf as you want to be, like all the way in so you hear nothing, or like out a little bit so you can hear a little.
If I got subtitles, I don't want to hear nothing.
Okay, mm-hmm. It's your call.
No, I'm a bit slightly out. Because I'm not going to be able to talk with them.
You can. You'll just sound funny. You know how that works. Yep.
Alright. So since... Can I get that back? Because I wasn't sure if I was actually supposed to be hearing it.
So it is... Have to be wise and crafty to figure out where it hides. Because it sits among the others that sleep in the month of August, found within 42 dead leaves. And again, if this doesn't, if this isn't like, there's no way to figure this out, we can do this with rolls.
You mean if we're bad at riddles?
Yep.
You want us to fess up to being bad at riddles and quit? Absolutely yep. not. It's not cicadas.
No. Oh, well, unless you think you can scan cicadas in this room.
Okay. Well, I don't know. They do preserve cicada shells. I mean, they're pretty when they mold.
A quick glance around does not actually show one of those cicada skins that you were referring to, because I know what you're at. Okay. You look for it. It's not there. Because it is a weird one.
To sleep in the leaves.
Katie's gonna go over to Blair and she's gonna start talking about the riddle. And then she's going to, in a pause, making sure her back is turned to the dev and the doctor,
mm-hmm.
is going to mouth that the doctor has earplugs in.
Oh. Can Blair read lips?
Let's say yes.
Okay, so I don't know if you're going to be like, oh, no, that's a roll for that. Yeah,
no,
oh, great, absolutely.
No, the rolls are dumb if we don't need them.
Cool. Interesting. Blair is going to continue to play the game with her wholehearted attention, but you know how, like, if you put your thumb over your phone speaker, it makes the noise different? She's going to accidentally... like continue to cover like her phone speaker while she's doing this.
Oh, I'm a boomer. I don't know what I'm doing with this phone.
Oh, you know, my grandson got me this new phone and it's very large. How do you hold them? I have to use both hands.
You're just taking over Maggie's role at this point.
But so she'll just, yeah, so she's now like just slightly muffling the noise.
Yeah.
Is it?
It muffles.
They go to sleep in August. It's such a weird thing.
But to be clear, there are 3, 4, 5 phones in this room that are playing that music synchronized.
Yeah.
At least they're synchronized.
It could be worse, yeah. It is it is specifically synchronized.
Do I see anything in the room with my phone up that looks like leaves or has a calendar or...
Okay, so we're going to do spot hidden stuff.
Yeah.
Find stuff. If you guys want to try and find stuff, spot hidden.
Sure, yeah.
Yeah, I won't lie. I am in fact bad at riddles.
But this is I even thought this was a weird one. But
I'm good at riddles, but I think I'm missing a part because I keep trying to write it down. And there's that. Yeah, I'm missing something.
It hides. It goes to sleep. It's hiding among others. Similar. It implies to me, hiding among others, believes with others, goes to sleep in August. Something I've forgotten. 42 dead leaves. Hides with others. Sleep in August. 42 dead leaves. I don't know. It's Flair's birthday. She'll point the point at herself. It's her birth. It's Flair's age. She'll point the point at herself.
I don't have the wah 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 horns for your phone to make.
Oh well, that's a good try.
You fire that spot in.
Oh yeah. All right. So.
You can find something.
I'll roll.
I would even maybe allow, like, psychology for figuring out a riddle and stuff. Spot hidden. You made it. It's a success. Psychology. That is just very slightly better. So. So Logan gets this one. You're like, okay. Blah, 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 blah. Sits among others in the month of August, found within 42 dead leaves. With others, August. Leaves. Then you're like, not like leaf, you're like leaves of paper, and your eyes immediately go to the bookshelf. And there's a lot of, you're like scanning your phone over, and it starts changing color a little bit, and you get a little bit of insight because you can see the code running. It gets a little more like excited line. And the area is seems to be this line of books that is months, January, February, March, April, May, of a journal of sleep studies. Because you're in a sleep clinic. You hover your phone around a little bit, and the code starts going a little more when you get to the one that says August. And you sit there for a minute and like, okay, it's not actually giving me like a success thing. Is this like, and you get a little like HREF line of code, like, need corresponding page.
So I would take the book off, open it to page 42.
You open it to page 42. I'm going to do two things. One, I'm going to have you give me a quick extra spot hidden check. But when you open it to page 42, hover your phone over it. A little red, like, ruby appears in the middle of your screen. And the, weirdly from off-screen, there's like a speech bubble in the direction that the sock monkey is currently in regards to you. It says, you got 200 XP!
Then you want me to do a spot hidden, right?
Uh-huh.
Fail!
Fail. That's pretty big. Oh. mean, if you wanted to, you could push it. Don't have to push it.
No. My spot hidden is not that good.
Fantastic. Everybody else sees him do this. I'm going to allow both of the others to throw spot hiddens if you so wish.
Sure. Oh, that seems to have worked in Shovel Over.
Ouch. 96.
Since I'm looking at a book, there's no way I could use library use, right?
It's pretty obvious, so I will allow you to use library use if you really want to. There's a better chance. Oh, it's still a thing.
Why?
Nobody. Like this. Nobody.
But it pops up on everybody's phones, right? So, like, the NPCs could theoretically.
Basically, everybody kind of like, oh, you figured it out, and everybody kind of goes over, and you hear the bling, 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 bling. Everybody kind of gets it. Oh, okay.
Besides the spot hidden, could I just read the page?
So the page itself seems to be going over like studies in like sleep studies and stuff. You specifically, being you, would notice this is weird sleep study stuff. This is specifically talking about studies of sleep paralysis and what people have experienced during. It's weird.
Fun.
A lot of depictions of, like, the things that people see, that how it can be explained away psychologically, rationally.
You said there was no way to take a picture or, like, minimize the app, right?
You can take screenshots, apparently.
Ooh, well.
You can still do that with your phone. So, yes, you can technically take pictures.
She will do her best to... I mean, if the gem is gone now, you know, after you do the thing.
It is.
She'll take a screenshot of the page itself to get those images.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Kleck and Thorne are like, this is actually pretty lovely. And Sam's like, we put some more work on it. Kind of like an hourglass starts spinning like it's trying to get up the next thing. Dave, the NPC, kind of like puts his phone down, is like, yeah, we did this before. This is the same music. What did you do? This isn't like infuriating like it was before. What did you do? Because I remember this music distinctly, and this is it, but it isn't it. What's going on with this? And text starts to go on your screens again, but the conversation kind of just keeps happening off to the side. Like, and Dr. Click actually responds, oh, I put a sub-audible track underneath it to make it a little less abrasive. And the game dev basically goes, yeah, well, it saves us from having to, you know, write a whole new track of music and pay for another one. And it'll help us get it out to market faster.
Can Blair try to guess by reading the page and use the library use role?
What are you trying to find? The page is there.
Well, it's just advance the thing. I mean,
oh, move on to the next thing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So eventually it loads the next thing, and everybody kind of gets the same thing. The sock monkey once again kind of appears on your screen. It kind of like little bad 3D walks over on the desk, like flopping around like a cute little mascot. And you look up, still sitting where it was. It's like, you did well, my friend. Can you find my next gem? It is trapped, and only the Red Guard knows where it lies.
It's trapped. So is there anything in the room that looks like a Red
Absolutely.
Guard, a nutcracker?
So specifically, there is a big Christmas nutcracker there. Like, this, like, seems to have gone from, like, this is, like, intensely difficult to this is mind-numbingly easy very quickly. It is seeming like it's trying to judge you.
Sure.
But...
okay. Blair's gonna hard commit, so if anybody else wants to do something, and then Blair will advance it. She's...
You go. As soon as you put the camera over the thing... Hey, you got 200 more experience! It's, like, very poppy.
I leveled up.
And it's exactly the kind of stuff that Logan pointed out before. They use specific sounds to keep people addicted. They use specific reinforcements to keep people onto these things. It's... you're noticing every little addictive trait that game design has, from casinos to Candy Crush. All right here.
I instantly thought of doo 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 doo.
Mm-hmm. Makes you feel a thing, doesn't it?
Makes you think.
Makes you feel a thing.
Okay. So I'm still like just kind of glancing around the room and seeing if I'm noticing any stress on anybody or.
So it seems to be kind of like the opposite of stress. It seems like the two people who did not come in with you seem to be a little less into what they were into before. This Dave guy seems like he was like pretty like bracing himself for this shitty phone app again, like he didn't really want to be here. And now he's just kind of like, he's just kind of vibing and kind of going along with it. The TikTok starlet or whatever the hell she's using these days seems to be less focused on whatever her other thing was, and is kind of just like getting into the game. She's like more relaxed, more focused.
Interesting.
There is a change.
Guess I'm gonna start messing with my phone again, see if I can get the next prompt.
Mm-hmm. Do me a favor. Give me a luck roll. Just roll luck. See what happens. Nope. Excellent.
Oh, no.
Excellent. Luck's not with you.
It's never going to be with me.
So, the game kind of just is continuing to move on a little bit as everybody engaging with the game.
Mm-hmm.
Not very far away from the shelf where those books were is where that that specific box that you were into is sitting. And the room is kind of like separated and everyone is kind of milling around and like doing stuff. So you have your opportunity, should you wish, to get a little closer and check it out. If you want to be, you know.
There's writing on the outside, you said. She'd probably go see if she could decipher that. She's a professional, you know?
Professional.
She's not going to, like, get overcommitted to this.
Okay. So... you can definitely check it out. That's not going to require, like, a roll or anything. You do note that the books, it's kind of being used as like a bookend.
Okay.
Against these like books that I would say, like these ones are kind of the ones I'm referring to as I'm blinking at on the screen there.
Sure.
The little bumps and stuff on it, they seem to be less writing. They seem to be like little studs and patterns. You do note that the books that it is propped up are not all of the books on the shelf seem to have like a name on them who they are addressed to. The book that was brought down from the shelf for the thing was to Dr. Hans Kleck. The books that this thing is propping up is to a Dr. Nils Garmel. Notably different name.
Okay.
and there's a little behind one of those ducts there, you actually do notice like the a similar looking, like it would be like a nameplate that would go on a desk, kind of like Dr. Klex is, but this is kind of pushed up in like behind for some reason.
Interesting.
Like not like discarded, but kept.
Sure, but like hidden.
Mm-hmm. And you go to check out this box. Mm-hmm. And this one I actually am going to have you do a... what would this be? It would probably be like a high score for you. So it would probably be like library use or anything involving like the written word. Any skills that you have there.
Library use is probably
library use would probably be good. Okay, so that's good. You note
that's
that...
That's not history, if you think that's more relevant.
No, it would not actually be in this, because library use would be perfect. Okay. I do not know if Blair can actually read the American Braille system, but looking at it, you can tell this is Braille. These little bumps and squiggles and lines and things. They're not squiggles, they're like dots and dashes. It's Braille. Sure.
She probably has some sort of grasp of a couple of languages, just in the things she comes across often. I'd say she would recognize it for sure.
Okay.
She'll take a screenshot on her phone.
It makes the fucking camera noise again.
Okay, at which point she'll say, "This is quite an interesting box. I was just looking for other clues and things, but this is really neat."
Oh, yes. Dr. Click actually kind of, like, leans around the game dev and kind of, like, gets away from it while people are checking stuff. At this point, the game is, like, rather simple. Everybody is going through. It's like the riddles have kind of devolved into much more simple things like... I am like an egg, only flat as a pancake. And it's like, there's like an oval table in the room. And you guys kind of go and if you choose to engage with the game and boop it, you're like, bling, 200 points or whatever. Dr. Kleck comes over to Blair specifically. Oh yes, that belonged to my predecessor and mentor.
Oh, it's beautiful, you know. I actually noticed it when I came in. Just the studding on the brass. It's very neat. Is it something he's collected?
It was a keepsake. He kept it with him for a long time. I know that much at least. He taught me a lot about sleep studies.
Of course, it's very interesting. What do you keep inside of it?
I don't know. I don't intend on opening it. I don't even know if it can be opened, honestly. He just had it, and it was among the items. There was a bit of a fire, and he passed some years back. It's more of a keepsake for me to remember him by.
Oh, of course. Well, my condolences.
I thank you. He's great in the study. Great, great in the study. And I wouldn't be the man that I am today without him.
Did he inspire your work with this, with like getting into game development and things?
The game development thing is a new thing. I mostly just wish to help people with sleep and subconscious problems, things of that nature. And he kind of actively like puts his back a little bit between the game dev behind him and you, so they can talk like just a little bit privately. Mm-hmm. He's like, I've worked with Deep Dive once or twice before. They knew I was at least apt with technology, and they asked for a way to make the music less annoying and maybe a little more engaging for the players. So it's a subdermal tone that
we use in sleep studies that kind of relaxes people and puts them in a state of suggestion. It's right next to the wall of sleep.
Very interesting. So, how long have you had this kind of the sound? Is this something that's new, or...?
This has been used for decades and decades. Dr. Garmel really pioneered this sort of thing. He was very, very close to sleep studies and being able to understand what it is that people do when they cross the threshold of consciousness. And he seems to get a little like metaphysical about it, like he kind of goes on and on a little bit.
Sure.
While this conversation is happening, because it is engaging and taking a bit of time, Katie, what are you just continuing to go along with the game?
She's actually gonna sidle up to Logan, and kind of look. She heard him talking to the game dev about the code and whatnot. I'm doing this because I just realized I have a really good computer use skill. but she's gonna, you know, kind of get up next to him and just start talking to him and be like, she's talking to him, but she's looking at the code.
Okay. Cool.
And she's just kind of like, you know, they really want us to be engaged in this. See if anything happens when you just, like, go idle. And she's gonna, like, keep looking at the code.
Okay. You guys do that?
Mm-hmm.
You sit idle for a moment. The code seems like it pauses, like it's waiting for input. And then there's a tick, like there's a... It sensed that nothing has happened. And it sensed that nothing has happened. In a pretty regular interval, right? And then, in something that skips past that regular interval, kind of breaks the pattern, breaks the drum beat, if you will. There's like a doo-doo-doo sound that comes from your phone. Like a knocking, almost. And on the phone, on the floor, the little sock monkey's looking up at you. Its little 3D image walked over and it looks sad. And Katie hears, and Logan sees on subtitles, "I need you to help me."
Is there anything weird going on with the code at all?
It stopped.
Interesting.
So the monkey is talking to us, but there's no code.
Mm-hmm.
I'm still not going to engage. I want to see if this is trying to get me to engage.
Yeah.
Okay. It sits there for a minute and like, kind of like almost like worries in place a little bit, and then it like looks up at you again to like almost like as if you like didn't hear it. Like I need you to help me. I need you to get me out of here.
Is there anything on the phone besides the monkey?
It's just like your camera and it's like looking mm-hmm. at the floor. And the monkey is on the floor looking up at you.
Okay. There's like nothing else like around the room or...
Nothing that you can see. Again, goes, "I need to go home. He trapped me here." It's like waving its little hands.
What happens if I touch the phone? I'm not going to talk to the...
You touch it. There's a little, like, burst of static. like it like glitches, like digitizes for a second, and then when it comes closer, the sock monkey is like grabbing onto the phone, like, I need you to get me the fuck out of here.
Both of you, access.
Both of you two specifically, give me a spot hidden.
Wait, how bad I am at these.
Mm-hmm. Cool.
Let's go.
Fantastic. You both have the instinctive thing, like the fucking sock monkey's there. You look over to the desk. The sock monkey is not on the fucking desk. Outside of the game. In real life.
Was it... When was the last time I remember seeing it?
Around the beginning of the game. So, 5 minutes ago.
I suck, it's butt-headed.
Hmm. She's gonna straight up just, like, kind of look around.
Okay.
Same.
So, you both got pretty good spot hiddens. Blair is kind of like chatting up the doctor. The game dev is sitting there and just kind of like not really paying attention. It looks like he's looking down at his phone, but it doesn't look like a game sort of thing. Looks like he's just scrolling. The other two testers seem to be also like have like the face of maybe they just saw something weird too. And aren't sure what they believe.
I'm gonna look at Logan. Keep an eye on the phone. She knows he can't hear her, but
you can mouth
she's
it.
She's kind of like, just keep an eye on the phone. I'm gonna keep playing.
Seems
so
like
she's gonna
idea.
See on her phone if she can still play.
You can.
And the monkey is just on his phone.
Nope, it's on your phone now. And it kind of like, when you look at your phone again, you see this big like a sock monkey doesn't have fingers, but it's just like a big nub on the end. It like slaps the camera like it's on the other side of a window saying, you two, get me the fuck out of here. He trapped me here. I need out.
Do I have access to the keyboard on my phone?
Because you're in dev mode, yeah, you do.
Type how.
Your whole screen glitches out for a second, and instead of, like... Your screen looks very different than everybody else's because it's, like, white text over the phone, and it is blinking with the key is in the box.
Okay. I'm going to make my way toward Blair and the doctor.
At that point, the conversation that has happened while this strange phenomenon has occurred is the conversation has kind of turned to what this guy's mentor was into, and it was, as you read before, a lot about sleep paralysis. And how he was like really big on helping people be able to rest properly in, he's being metaphorical with, and he really refers to it as a land of dreams, which you think is odd. It was his life's work to allow people to sleep safely.
Interesting, very interesting. And so you've taken that up?
It is... I've tried to. It seems to be more challenging these days. There's so many more stimuli that affect us when we sleep, as you see. And he tries to gesture towards the people playing a cell phone game, but sees people approaching and is kind of like, oh, hello.
I'm sorry, I'm just... Play the game. Something going on over here.
Oh, by all means, please. Please, I hope you enjoy. But
kind of, like, look over him, trying to get, like, her attention, like,
I'm not going to make that a roll. If she wants to pick up on it, she can.
Yeah.
While he's going towards Blair and the doctor, Katie's going to go over to, like, the other people playing. Mm-hmm. And just kind of, like, glance at their phones and see if they're also seeing the monkey begging to be set free.
The monkey.
When you look at their phones, it looks weirdly fuzzy. You have a moment of looking at their phones, looking at their face, and looking at their phones where you can tell that you're looking at their phones and you can't see anything really on it. It looks like kind of discernible, like almost like you're looking at the room through like really cloudy water. It's fuzzy to you. But when you look at their faces, it is clear from how they are reacting that they see something. And briefly, if you glance at your phone again, the little sock monkey is like, "The doctor trapped me here. Don't tell him. Don't talk to him. Get me out."
Why is every sock monkey picture creepier than the last, dude?
And it goes, "Don't tell him anything."
So, if I got the connection over to Blair, am I close enough to the box and his attention's away from the box that I can try to sleight of hand it?
You want to try and sleight of hand the box?
Yes.
Okay. I'm going to allow the attempt. The Blair, you guys kind of ease this. It's like you guys have done this routine before. She does just the right thing to distract him, and you need like a quarter of a second window to do it, and you use an eighth of it. Like, it's like clockwork. Boom, you got it. Just, and it's like concealed already.
Perfect.
And you feel your phone vibrate. This game hasn't had it vibrate before, and it's like, not like vroom, vroom, like it stops, like it's the slow, like a rumble pack, like drrr, like it keeps going.
Oh, can't wait to see this. Look at my phone.
You look at your phone. What are you pointing the phone at? Because it's still a camera.
I guess to the floor.
To the floor. It is, since you have lines of text, your developer mode has gone insane. And it is basically repeating, "Let me out, let me out, let me out, let me out, let me out," over, 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 in varying font sizes and, like, in such a way that is, like, frantic. If text coming at you can seem to have a tone, it is excited, or like it's emotionally charged.
I'm gonna use the keyboard I have and ask, "Who are you?"
It, like, the thing vibrates again and it just says, "Prisoner."
Oh, this feels like a trap.
What are you called?
Your phone responds with all, like, one word at a time, like snapping really fast. So you, it's like in your face, said, "I'm called, let me the fuck out." One word at a time.
I have the box. You're not going to be let out until I know who you are.
Neat. Okay, so I'm gonna need you to give me a check, and I just have to figure out what that check is. Yeah, so this is how this is probably going to have to go. You're gonna need to give me a dodge check. Excellent. So, do you say that out loud, or do you type it?
It's all type.
Cool. You type it, and the text goes from white to red, and then you feel in your hand your phone suddenly start to get hot, and with a successful dodge check, you drop your phone right before it, like, actually, like, breaks. There's like a little bit of a spill of like glass and stuff shooting across the room, but it's far enough, like, you've already thrown it away that you didn't actually take damage from it. Looking at it, like, if you didn't catch that and you didn't have your fast fingers that you do in your career, you might have lost a finger or two. And there's a sudden, like, okay. This is why I didn't want developer mode on, sir. We probably don't want to do that again in the future, okay? Are you all right? Are you fine?
I don't know. I think I need to, like, take a break. I mean, it's kind of intense. You broke my stuff. Can I just, like, go out and get some air?
Mm-hmm. Like, I think that might be a good idea. Okay, okay. And he's, like, mentally trying to get himself together and, like, handle this. The most important one is going to be Logan here. I need you to make a spot hidden, but both of our other players can also make spot hiddens that will have different results.
My spot hidden sucks.
Okay. Fail. Cool.
Wrong thing.
Ah.
I still failed anyway.
So...
You know what? Just for the funs.
Uh-huh. You gonna try and push it?
I'm gonna try to push it.
Okay, try and push it.
How do I do that?
Just roll again.
God damn it. It was so worse.
Now, in these games of dice that we play, sometimes failures make things a lot more interesting. And this time, it has. Blair, you notice this as the TikTok lady, whose name you never got, seems to be like, kind of like, about the whole thing. Everyone's distracted except Blair in this situation because, I mean, Logan's phone fucking exploded. Blair, you see a brief thing on Dave's screen, blinking with the same, let me out, let me out, let me out. Dave manages to come up behind and tries to take the box from Logan.
Blair sees this?
Blair sees it across the room, because you are far away from that whole thing, which is why you didn't end up taking any damage or anything from exploding glass flying across the room.
Right, one second while I read my notes. What Big Dave with the chain of numbers. What was the chain? The chain of numbers doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter.
He yells his username.
It's Big Dave.
She'll be like, hey, yeah, she'll be like, Big Dave, whatever the numbers are.
Cool.
You posted on Reddit about this, didn't you? And that'll be how she, like, turns everybody's attention to him suddenly, hopefully.
So here's how this goes. All at once, this kind of happens. He doesn't actually, like, try and pickpocket off of this guy because Logan's fucking got it. You fucking palmed it. Like, not gonna release it at all. Blair says this to him, and you notice immediately as the words are leaving your mouth that this probably isn't going to work because throughout this whole game, his face has been getting more and more slack and more relaxed. And instead of trying to take it from Logan's hand, he reaches, puts a finger on the side of the box, and flips the lid. Logan feels this, and he feels the box move a little bit. And it is at this point where I gotta ask, what does he do in that moment?
Try to shut the box.
Try to shut the box. Cool. I'm gonna say this is gonna be kind of an opposed check here, which means I have to open up a character sheet. I'm gonna say, because it's a fast thing, roll me on your stats, not a skill, on your stats. Dexterity. Opposed. All right, so you got a 76 out of 80. Cool. Let's see what happens. Dave wins. So, what happens is you both reach for it.
I just have to beat him.
Yeah, you have an opposed check. So you both roll against each other, and whoever gets the better one wins.
Would he luck this roll?
On opposed checks, you cannot push or luck or anything like that.
Oh, so I can't spend luck to get the last
not
five
on
I
this
need?
One.
Okay, that's what I wanted to make sure of.
Not on this one. Not on only on opposed checks. If it's just like a regular check, yes.
Gotcha.
But what happens is this. It feels like the box is shaking in the exact the same way that your phone was. And there's a jerk. And you have this moment of your, basically your rough life, your life on the road. You have an innate survival instinct. And your first reaction is probably the safest thing to do is to not be touching this box right now.
So dodge, like throw it away.
Do you give into it or do you try to hold on to it? It is your choice. You can try and override that, but it feels like letting go of that shit is probably a better idea.
And there's no, like, closing the box at this point.
He's opened it.
It's already open. I've already felt a jerk like something jumped out.
Yep. So you move. The box comes down. Normally with a wooden box like this, he would like hit the ground and like bounce a little bit. No, it goes thump, perfectly sticks to the ground. A hand with too many fingers comes out. Reaches around to the edge. And you hear free as something is trying to crawl out. So what's everybody doing?
If I put my phone at it.
Actually, you do that.
Do anything?
You
yeah.
do that and you see like a sock monkey happy like this.
Okay.
Like full praise the sun. Like if a sock monkey could evil cackle.
Where is this box? Because so Logan was over by Blair, right? And then
I
wandered
say
away.
It's probably like 4 feet from you on the floor.
Okay.
So not terribly close, but close enough.
Gotcha. And the doctor has moved away. Is that correct?
Everybody has backed the fuck up. The first thing that happens is the game developer runs towards the door, starts jiggling the doorknob. It's not opening.
Is there a chance that I could flip the lid if I like?
There is. There's only one way to find out. We're gonna have to try. What is it that you would like to do? And we will figure out a role that will see if we can make that happen.
So this is just like a tiny box, like yay big, like, and it's just a giant hand coming out.
Clearly that hand already is too big to fit inside.
and a hand is coming out.
Oh, I don't have enough skill for this. But I have a dumb plan.
This is my favorite part of these games.
I don't have the dice for this. You've been very mean to us.
So, my idea is to go to the box, jam the gun that I have always on me into its wrist.
You brought a gun to a sleep clinic. Awesome. Perfect. Great. Okay, cool.
Pull the trigger, hope it breaks the wrist, the hand off, and shut the lid.
Okay. So there's a moment where this thing clearly isn't out yet, but this is definitely possible. While other people think if they're going to try and do something, I'm going to let this dice roll out. So.
Oh, I know what I'm going to do, so.
You know what you're going to do?
Yeah.
Is it going to supplement this, or is it going to be different?
No, it's different.
Okay. So what are you going to do?
She's going to intimidate the doctor. She's going to pin him to a wall and say, what the fuck is in that box?
Cool. Okay, so you're going to do that. Katie, what you got?
Katie's thought is to run over and start stomping on the hand.
Fantastic. Okay. So we're going to do...
Logan could bring a gun, but she couldn't exactly, you know, sneak her shotgun in.
That's true.
I have a tiny little revolver.
Yeah, hunting rifle. All right, so here's how this is going to go.
This is so dumb.
I'm going to say, since you both are working in consort, the first thing that is probably going to happen is going to be the role that Katie will do to try and do the stomp. After that, we're going to say she will try and stomp it down. Logan is going to try to fire once her foot is clear of that. And then we will do the social stuff with the doctor. Does this sound like what you guys want to do before we initiate dice rolls?
Yeah.
Sure.
Good news, Blair. You don't gotta roll dice. You're just doing it.
Yay. I have a question about order of operations here.
Uh-huh.
Because I know what the intentions are. So if the intention is to try and, like, break the wrist, wouldn't it be better for him to shoot it and then her to try and, like, curb stomp it off the edge?
Depends on how you guys want to do it.
That sounds... I like that plan.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I gotta remember how fucking... I don't think we actually need to get into the full-blown initiative rules, which I'm going to look up now because this is, like, pre-combat here. So,
yeah.
Whoever is taking the first action, which I believe is Logan, that means you get to make me a firearms check that'll be under the combat tab in your character sheet, because you have one of those, and you'll just click whatever weapon that you have in there, and it should try and make you use it.
Yeah, because... Logan would get to it first anyway, because she's on the other 45. Side of the room. 45.
Okay, so here's the deal with that. You can't push a roll. You can use luck. You could burn 5 luck and make that a success.
I'm going to burn it.
All right, so click the little edit button on your character sheet. It'll make you be able to write stuff. Reduce your luck 5 points.
Oh, I did that and it disappeared.
So, okay, that's fine. That is technically a success. So Logan comes over and fucking fires into the hand on the box. Cool. Katie, I believe there should be, like, either under combat, there should either be unarmed or brawl or something like that. Because I don't actually have a actual character sheet. Let me jump into somebody's sheet who is not you.
Yeah, I got it. Brawl.
Okay. Give her a success. Okay. So here's how this goes. A couple of things happened at once. And of all things, we're actually going to start with... we're actually going to begin with Blair on this. You grab the doctor and slam it against the wall. Turn that down a smidge.
Things fall off the bookshelf, you know.
Things definitely fall off the bookshelf. And what did you ask him specifically?
What the fuck is in that box?
He stares down at the box, like over your shoulder at it, like he's like not resisting being pinned, and he's just kind of like looking over your shoulder, like,
I thought he was just making shit up. For both Katie and Logan, I need you to click on the sanity button on your character
sheet. I can't get my character sheet to pop back up.
I can do it for you if you need to. So what you can do, it's either popped out somewhere.
No, it I went to edit and it disappeared, and then I haven't been able to get it back since.
So that'll be under, because I can have it here. So where the chat is, there's the little thing, there's the little paintbrushing thing, and then there's a little one next to it that says journal. Click on that, and you should be able to see Logan Russ.
Yeah, I click on it, nothing happening.
Okay. So I don't know exactly what's going on, but I have access to your character sheet, so I can click the button for you. But basically, you're seeing something terrible and you need to make a sanity check. So for, you can actually probably close out of roll 20 and open it back up if you really want to make the roll yourself.
That's what I'm doing it.
Okay.
Nope. That's what I was doing.
Then I won't fuck with you. But Katie, roll me a sanity as a failure.
Oh, Katie.
Okay, cool. All
right, and then you need me to roll sanity? Where's that at?
It's just in your stats. It's at the top in the green. It'll be on the bottom right, I believe, of the stat blocks. Cool.
Do we both fail?
You both failed.
Yep.
It's not gonna be too bad this time. Maybe. Let me see. Let me look at this. I want to make sure I'm doing this correctly. Yeah.
And I already pushed my luck enough to.
That's fine. Of Logan and Katie, have either of you ever experienced sleep paralysis?
As a character or me?
Either.
No.
Cool.
I have.
Cool. So, Katie knows this immediately when she sees it. This is probably directly a thing from her dreams that she probably had since back in the day when she ran into some weird shit. How the fuck did somebody trap a sleep paralysis demon in a box? And now you're stomping on its hand. So, on your character sheets, you are going to lose, dice roll, however many that is, 5. Sanity points are going to drop by 5. Max. Or just not max, but you lose 5. That's it. But you guys see something truly horrible. It's a monster from Nightmare. And I'm going to show you what you would have had to deal with if you didn't pull this off, because what would have crawled out that you can see, like it's a tunnel going down trying to crawl out, is this fucking thing that was trying to get out of the box. But Logan shoots that motherfucking thing through the hand, and it... And Katie starts stomping on the box lid. 1, 2, 3. And it seals. And it's closed again.
I immediately pick that bitch up and tuck it somewhere.
I have a backpack. Blair has a leather backpack.
I take my belt and like wrap it around it and lock it.
Excellent. You do that. There is a bit of a slight resistance to you trying it, but the latch is closed. Katie pulled that off.
Yeah, shake how you want, bitch.
I picture Blair still has this guy on the wall, and Logan's just digging in her backpack, and she's like, yeah, it makes sense.
I'm going to close the app. Is there a number that, or is there something that we know to call for
you can always call
cleanup in these situations?
You can always call the home office.
Do we want to, though?
The question is, can we pick up any phone and just, like, have it be in our attention and be connected? Is that how that works for calling the office? I gotta report in.
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah, I mean, you can. Yeah.
Great. Liminal phones. Liminal telephone line. I love it.
Yep.
She's going to look at Logan and Blair and go, are we calling for cleanup now?
Oh, we're stopping the developer from leaving.
I was about to say, I'm pointing my gun at the developer if he's still out the door.
He spins around. He didn't actually make it out the door. The door seemed locked. He seemed like he finally might have, like, undone the latch enough to go, and he turns around and sees, he goes like, whoa, 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 and he, like, backs up against the wall. Like, he just stops.
Where? Over on the wall over there, away from the door.
And sign up for the shit, man. And he just very slowly moves over next to the wall.
What's going on with the two testers who were more involved?
So the female is like leaning on that desk and is kind of like she's starting to like a fog is starting to clear or something. Actively, you note that weird music that has been filling the room the whole time is gone now. Except for Logan, who still has his earplugs in. The Dave guy on the floor is sitting there, staring at the box, wide-eyed and hyperventilating. And there is a small puddle forming beneath him.
Okay.
I point the gun at the other two and tell them to move over by the developer.
There's a lot of, oh my god, oh my god, oh my god, oh my god. And they do it and they comply.
Perfect. I have dealt with the area.
Katie's going to call HQ, call for a cleanup squad, say that we have completed the mission and have something in our custody.
May I ask what exactly that you have in your custody, please? On the other end of the phone.
Out of game, she would know that it's safe to tell them something like that.
If it's DMOS, which it is, yes, it is absolutely safe to tell them that.
We seem to have a sleep paralysis demon in our custody.
There's a full 5-second pause in here. Huh, that's new. Okay, we'll send a team out. It's fucking... Severin's not back yet. We'll send somebody else. It's fine. All right. Right. And the phone clicks.
Katie is then going to turn to the rest of the room, and she's going to look at the dev, the doctor, and the two testers. And go, we'd like to thank you for your cooperation tonight. You may have a lot of questions, and honestly, we're not going to give you any answers. The answers you get and the way this all pans out will depend on the answers that you can give our team and just how much involvement you've had in this experiment tonight. So, make yourselves comfortable, and we'll get this all cleaned up as soon as we can.
Blair, like, you see Blair, like, hear you say that and be like, that's, like, you can see it set all over her body. She's like, she's being really reasonable. And then she's like, yeah, not you two. You two, we're questioning now. And she'll point at the dev and the guy. The other two can go sit. But we need to talk about this.
Just as a heads up, this is a very different air from what you've gotten from Katie so far.
Completely.
So far, she's been very research, very fact-finding, very quiet, and this is just a completely different personality has turned on.
Fair. Yes. He was like, ah, that was very professional, but I was like partway through questioning this guy when the shit went down, and I don't really want to stop that. So she's going to be like, well, not you, you stay here.
Dr. Kleck, if allowed, just like kind of like slumps down and clearly his own chair.
Sure, yeah, that's fine. You want to tell me more about this box now?
Let me see, I'll pull up information here. I was telling you the truth. Dr. Garmel was my mentor, and this, he died back in 92, and this was found amongst the things in his office.
And how did you say he died?
Well, the police said that they weren't sure exactly what happened, but they said it was, and he's like not looking at you the whole time. He's staring at the box, which is like bound up and shit right now.
Mm-hmm.
They said it was a breaking and entering, but he said there was blood, and there was a little bit of a fire. But otherwise, he was like, but his room was locked from the inside. I don't.
So you didn't know anything about this and its relationship to the game, this phone app.
No, I did for this game was give the sub-audible tone to make the music more palatable, I guess, and maybe to make the. And then a light kind of clicks on in his head. And to bring the players of the game closer to the walls of sleep. And he kind of sinks in his chair a little bit more. Like, he doesn't say, oh no, out loud, but it's in his face.
Having just had this man pressed against the wall and he's now in the chair, so he's going to kind of like pat his shoulder and go, all right, I appreciate you answering my questions, honestly. And then she'll turn her attention to the dev, this, like, 25-year-old child.
Mm-hmm.
And she'll be like, so what do you know?
Katie is going to stop her for a second,
uh-huh.
Look at the dev and go, give me your phone.
Good call.
So, we'll end this up pretty quickly here. The scene will actually conclude with Katie asking for this guy's phone. Logan essentially having both of these people at gunpoint. Everybody looking at this game dev from Pentex who is being asked for his phone. And the scene basically ends with this guy going, I want to talk to my fucking lawyer! Scene goes to black. We can definitely say that, in short, the cleanup team does arrive. The people involved do get hauled away into much nicer black Escalades than you drove here. A team of people in the STR strategic tactical response team do come out and in like a bigger white box with handles on the side, request you to put that box in this storage box, seal it, and everybody is permitted to move off-site with the people in question in custody.
Better make note of that belt. You won't be getting that back. You better ask for your
might be.
I don't want it back now.
No, but you should be buy one on their dime. Right, come on.
You'll be able to support one.
Please, I don't pay for anything.
I was going to say. So I believe all are very well and easy.
Did she do it? Did the game dev do it on purpose?
We don't know. It's going to have to be dug away in an interview. But you all safely make it back to HQ. And I'm going to say this is probably a really good point where we're going to end this particular session of DMOS. Now, for both players and the audience, we're not leaving just yet. Tiny little outro. I'm sure you've been noticing on the YouTube, which if you're not on the YouTube, I'm going to fucking click a thing in the chat right now.
I did it in the wrong chat.
It's fine. Head over there and
What we do after these are after action reports. This episode is going to be on YouTube. And if you're watching on YouTube, sorry, hearing this again. Tomorrow. And after all of our players have time to make up a little after action report, I make a little video about it. So you don't have to stick around for a 4 hour or however long it took us to do this video to understand what happened and what our DMOS employees have to go through. Yes, Severin is really good at interrogation. We'll see what we can pull off with this. But I want to thank you guys for having another run of DMOS. I think this is working out pretty well. Mm-hmm. Everybody have fun?
Yes.
This was good? Yeah. Excellent.
Mm-hmm.
Excellent. And nobody's dead yet.
Yeah.
This means I need to try harder.
Yeah, you know, it sounds like it's too easy. You should really amp up the difficulty for the next one.
I hate all of you.
I will be in the next one?
I was going to say, you guys are safe.
I have lost 5 sanity, okay?
I had
a lot of sanity to begin with.
There's a very good chance you might get that back if you write your after action report, because you get sanity rolls.
Yeah, not my rolls.
You ain't wrong.
He hated me tonight.